You know that satisfying sound you get when you crack open a coconut? Yep, we're talking about RoboCop.
Hold your breath.
RoboCop as a series consists of three films made from 1987 to 1993, and a remake made in 2014. Its tone and intended audience has changed radically between films, especially between the original series and the remake. Here, I'm looking at how and why. It's because Hollywood execs are RoboCop broadly is about a policeman who gets gunned down by villains and rebuilt as a cyborg by an amoral corporation. OCP are, really, the driving antagonists of all four films, utilising RoboCop as the PR pregame to taking valuable defence and security contracts that will make their corporation king. All four outings feature Alex Murphy, aka RoboCop, dealing with life being not quite the man he once was, but also an incredible force for justice. And the thematic backbone of the series is the juxtaposition of man and machine together. Murphy is limited by directives and by direct control, but RoboCop, you might argue, is limited by Murphy. RoboCop started life as a script derivative of Blade Runner, written by Edward Neumeier, about a policeman who becomes a robot. 3 years after writing his first draft, in 1984, Neumeier met Michael Miner, who had a similar script called SuperCop, about a cyborg policeman. They battled to the death, combined ideas, into a speculative script that would later become RoboCop. Paul Verhoeven's entry into major Hollywood film follows average good cop Alex Murphy on his first day at a new precinct in Detroit, a city on the verge of bankruptcy and consumed by crime. Also, it's the same in the movie, da-dum-tsh. There, Murphy and his partner Lewis end up pursuing some eclectically dressed thieves and Murphy gets too much shotgun. At the same time, we're privy to a subplot set in the higher echelons of Omni-Consumer Products, the Resident Evil corporation bent on occupying all the space in the military contracts game. There, young up-and-coming executive Bob Morton seeks to challenge the power of OCP's second-in-command, Dick Jones, by providing an alternative to Jones' malfunctioning attempt at a robotic police unit, ED-209.
Please put down your weapon. You have 20 seconds to comply. You now have 15 seconds to comply. You are in direct violation of penal...
This of course means Murphy, otherwise mortally wounded, is taken by OCP, who have privatised the police force, and turned into a valuable piece of property, RoboCop. RoboCop then proceeds to carry out the law without the burden of subtlety, nuance, or humanity. But boy, is it cool.
Dead or alive, you are coming with me. Let the woman go, you are under arrest.
You better back up, pal! He's gonna kill her!
Your move, creep.
RoboCop, still with some lingering memory from his previous life, pursues the gang that killed him. But ultimately, the real bad guy, Dick Jones, is protected by RoboCop's secret fourth directive.
It's a little insurance policy called Directive 4. My little contribution to your psychological profile. Any attempt to arrest a senior officer of OCP results in shutdown.
Dick Jones has most Michael Ironside, non-Michael Ironside, Clarence, played by Kurtwood Smith, kill Bob Morton. And then, as we start to realise OCP plans to carve Detroit up, so does RoboCop, after creating a lot of detailed in-the-field examples for the blood pattern analysts.
Come quietly or there will be trouble.
Also, note that even RoboCop, part of who is still Alex Murphy to some extent, seemingly wants to kill Clarence for taking his life away, he doesn't.
OCP runs the cops! You're a dumb!
I'm a cop.
RoboCop, of course, tries to arrest Dick Jones, and of course is stopped by Directive 4. Clarence then hunts him down on Dick Jones' orders, but with the help of Lewis, RoboCop prevails.
Not arresting you anymore. Hey, wait a second.
After defeating the gun-wielding baddies, RoboCop faces off in a kind of second climax with Dick Jones.
Dick, you're fired!
Thank you.
Notice how Murphy goes from letting Clarence live to saying that he's not going to arrest him. Much of the movie is about Murphy trying to break out of the RoboCop programming, but I think more importantly than that, thematically, RoboCop is about revenge. That's because it's a sci-fi western. There's the western tropes, the spinning gun, alive or dead, but more than that, there's the swashbuckling and righteous music. Music that sounds as if it's from a western. Basil Poledouris did the score for Conan the Barbarian, Red Dawn, and later another Paul Verhoeven film, Starship Troopers. I think out of all of his film scores, the ones that matter most to the films that they're in are RoboCop and Starship Troopers. In Starship Troopers, Poledouris' score is prideful, anthem-like fanfare. It belongs in the universe Starship Troopers is set in. In RoboCop, the main theme is almost the embodiment of the character. It ties orchestral and digital together, and I think on its own, it conveys part of what makes RoboCop an attractive idea. The music is getting things done music, like the title character in the vein of bringing order to lawless lands. It's as important to understanding what RoboCop is about as establishing the tone and the setting. Detroit might not be the jewel in the crown of very much these days, but RoboCop directly refers to the almost broken nature of that city that was almost producing feverishly high levels of alarm in the late 1980s. Unemployment was high, crime was high, and although the situation hasn't turned right around since then, especially with the city declaring bankruptcy, as RoboCop 2 predicted, in 2013, the broken-down Detroit of the late 1980s is important to RoboCop. Detroit was an industrial centre. The idea that it might regain its crown and relive its glory days thanks to robotics, but also the idea that such a thing would all be a ruse for profit, that's a very 1980s idea. I think it's cynical, but tied to the reality of Detroit's decay.
That's 2 million workers living in trailers. That means drugs, gambling, prostitution.
What I mean is you could set RoboCop in New York or LA, and it would work. But setting it in Detroit is an intentional comment, and RoboCop is full of those.
And the president's first press conference from the Star Wars orbiting peace platform got off to a shaky start.
You haven't dismantled your MX stockpile.
Pakistan is threatening my border!
That's it, Buster. No more military aid.
Nuke them. Get them before they get you.
10,000 acres of wooded residential land were scorched in an instant when a laser cannon aboard the Strategic Defense Peace Platform misfired today during routine startup tests.
There's clearly more than just reflection of fears of nuclear war. RoboCop plays with it, laughs at it even. So too, through the use of satirical commercials, RoboCop mocks the car industry and its advertising methods, healthcare, and most meta of all, the idea of what a hero is.
Robo, any special message for all the kids watching at home?
Ow. Stay out of trouble.
This is what I think makes RoboCop genuinely different. It's as if it exists on two sides of the same coin. On one side, from far away, RoboCop is a dumb action shooter. RoboCop goes into a Coke factory and kills everyone, and no one thinks to shoot at him in the jaw. But on the other side, it knows what it is, and it's playing with the genre. Give the microphone to RoboCop to voice his message, to voice the film's message, to tell the people a message of hope, to say that with great power comes great responsibility, and what does RoboCop do? He tells kids to stay out of trouble. RoboCop is a popcorn action movie at the same time as being a thoughtful satire, just as RoboCop is a robot at the same time as being a human. Verhoeven recalls that, when he first glanced through the script, he discarded it in disgust, but he went back to it and he found value in it. I think, although I obviously can't be certain, that part of the reason he went back to it is because the script asks a lot of questions. Not just questions about when the machine ends and the man starts, but questions about when the bureaucratic protocols of policing end and when the policeman starts. I feel like I might be a neckerchief away from sounding a little bit pretentious here, so let me finish this thought by saying, RoboCop isn't about machine-cold, calculated justice. It's about swashbuckling law-bringing, old westerns, Dirty Harry. These things aren't about bureaucratic procedure. They're about eliminating crime and evil. And whilst there may be philosophical questions and observations about society, the movie presents those things alongside a very compelling story. A story that makes you want to watch RoboCop triumph. A story that makes you want to watch RoboCop clean the streets. Some have called RoboCop fascistic because it does so well in making its audience cheer for the authority figure. But I think it's a very subversive movie, both in its content but also in its delivery. Murphy, reincarnated as a cyborg, is a horrific protagonist residing in a kind of purgatory where he's kind of human, but not enough to break out of what he's been programmed for. That's much deeper than just a human cop kicking down doors. As in Verhoeven's later film Starship Troopers, I think there's a deliberate impetus in the narrative where we might start wondering if our protagonists really are the good guys, or just tools of something not quite so good. RoboCop made $53 million at the US box office on its $8 million budget, and an additional $24 million from video rentals. RoboCop 2 was, arguably, inevitable. RoboCop 2 features a storyline where OCP deliberately incites the police to strike so that they can sell more police robots. Police robots, they can't get to work.
RoboCop 2.
It follows RoboCop as he tracks down Kane, messianic leader of a gang producing a new, highly addictive drug named Nuke. At the same time, an intra-office war rages at OCP, with ambitious executive Juliet Fax tasked with finding a willing mind for a new RoboCop. She, of course, why not, settles on conveniently deceased Kane and things are fine. Presumably Hitler's brain was unavailable. Can you imagine thinking that putting the messianic leader of a drug cult's brain into a Terminator is a good idea?
Bad synergy.
Anyway, Murphy and Kane have a very public showdown and RoboCop prevails, but OCP and the CEO escape justice yet again.
So many dead and wounded.
Of course, there won't be any trouble from the dead ones.
They'll have relatives. They always do.
RoboCop 2 is one of those sequels that was always going to be hard to follow on from the way the first one ended. At the end of the first one, we get this.
Nice shooting, son. What's your name?
Murphy.
Followed by some of the most watchable white text on black screen. RoboCop ends with Murphy remembering who he was, at least a little bit. RoboCop 2 doesn't so much reverse that as it comes up with reasons why Murphy is still stuck being RoboCop. OCP demands that RoboCop, Murphy, stops driving by his wife's house, and they force him to deny his humanity.
You are simply a machine.
I am a machine.
Nothing more.
Nothing more.
I'm not against this narratively. In fact, I think it's a great angle as it gives Peter Weller some acting to do, and I think he's pretty good. It's because of his reserved performance we might feel sorry for Murphy. But then that isn't really developed. It feels as though they brought in OCP suppressing RoboCop's humanity with the intention of not resolving anything until the third movie. It feels a bit like a wasted opportunity. The same might be said of Kane. He's billed as a cult leader in early news reports, but we never really get that sense, nor do his actions as a messianic leader really matter when his brain is implanted into RoboCop 2. RoboCop 2, the actual robot, could have been anyone. It could have been the robot that fell off the back of a truck that Kane and his gang reprogrammed. Don't get me wrong, RoboCop 2 is still a fun watch. It still has biting satire. But given that it was directed by the man behind The Empire Strikes Back, Irvin Kershner, I think you could have been forgiven for wanting more. Saying that, while some of its humour might feel a little on the nose...
Oh my... This isn't very nice.
...and sometimes feels a little out of place tonally, I think it's a genuine successor. It doesn't feel outrageously different, but I think it's put at a disadvantage because, in the first film, we don't see Murphy as RoboCop for 30 minutes. There's a lot of intrigue created in the first film from not seeing RoboCop immediately. A lot of intrigue is created from us watching RoboCop for the first time and seeing how he operates, and obviously they couldn't replicate that. The original writers left and were replaced with Frank Miller, and although the studio reportedly liked his ideas, most of Miller's work was dramatically changed by Wall and Green, although much of Miller's narrative remained. Interestingly, in RoboCop 2, the RoboCop suit, designed and created by Rob Bottin, the man behind most of the SFX work in The Thing and most approachable member of the Bee Gees, was this time made out of fiberglass. Peter Weller has said that the suit in RoboCop 2 was far freer and more accessible, something that's very important for a suit consisting of 60 components that an actor might have to wear for hours on end. I bring this up because it wasn't him wearing it in RoboCop 3. Instead, we get Robert John Burke, who does a decent enough job, and who was also in Thinner, as was Spangler. That last part might not be relevant, but I think the fact that Burke didn't fit into the suit, and that wearing the suit was painful for him, kind of sums up the production of RoboCop 3. Orion, who produced the first two films, filed for bankruptcy at the end of 1991, and the film was somewhat delayed because of this. Originally slated for a 1992 summer release, RoboCop 3 didn't come out in the US until 1993, in November. The whole thing with Orion and how they went from making $700 million from The Silence of the Lambs and Dances with Wolves to going broke is for an aside video, but I don't think it really gets RoboCop 3 off the hook. RoboCop 2 made $45 million at the US box office, and another $22 million from video rentals, all on a $35 million budget. That isn't great, and I think they took a risk with making a third, a risk that didn't pay off. It lost money, taking in less than half of its $22 million budget. As well as RoboCop 3 losing Peter Weller, and the man who played the OCP CEO, Dan O'Herlihy, the film is limited by Orion pursuing a PG-13 rating, and, what can I say, a mouldy sausage of a script. It follows RoboCop as he kind of accidentally joins a resistance led by Ch Pounder and Milton from Office Space, after Officer Lewis is killed by OCP's darling fascist bully boys. References that only 40-year-olds will get, NYPD Blue, St. Elsewhere, The Jeffersons, All in the Family. OCP, on the verge of bankruptcy and now inexplicably headed by Rip Torn, who manages to be both miscast and also underused, starts to use its urban rehabilitators to forcibly move people from their homes and make way for Delta City. Together with a Japanese corporation, OCP is directly the bad guy in this film. Although OCP's crashing isn't anywhere near as satisfying as it could be, as the company is already teetering on ruin when we join them. I thought RoboCop 2 did a pretty good job in leaving room for OCP to become the main villain in the third film, promising a story where the bad guys would finally be taken down. That really doesn't happen. RoboCop 3's antagonists really aren't OCP, but Paul McDaggett, played by John Castle, whose main villainous qualities are his Britishness.
No flashy bravery, Tin Man.
It's true, they are an evil bunch. Apart from Mr. British, boo, there's also Otomo, sent to stop RoboCop ruining everything, although really, there are several Otomos, all of whom RoboCop is forced to beat with a minimal fight choreography budget. After a brief civil war, OCP versus the people and jetpacking RoboCop, the CEO of the Japanese company arrives and cancels all the Detroit projects and everything is okay. There's a few laughs, there's a few pieces of satire, but in many ways, it's a retread.
Tell you what, Doctor, you talk me into it. His emotions, get rid of them. Find out where they're located and erase them. If that means wiping out his memory, that's too bad.
Yes, RoboCop 3, we've done this.
Do you have family?
Yeah, I have a brother in Pittsburgh, the one who doesn't call, you know that.
And it's a retread aimed at children. The graphic violence of the previous movies isn't what made them good, but it was part of the fun. RoboCop 3 doesn't have exactly the same sense of fun, and it is limited, and it feels often much more like a parody, or a simplified rip-off. It also has one of the worst lines of dialogue at the end of any movie. At the end of RoboCop 2, we have a quip about being human. It's not great, but it's something. At the end of RoboCop 3, Murphy says this.
Murphy, is it?
My friends call me Murphy. You call me RoboCop.
In the first film, it ends with RoboCop saying that his name is Murphy. That means something. He's back. He's human. He's won. At the end of the third film, he might as well have used my trademark catchphrase, talk to the hand, the receding hairline ain't listening. Patent pending. The director, Fred Decker, says it was one of the most enjoyable movies he's made. He might not have directed many films, but he is one of the writers on The Predator, reboot of Predator. Oh, thank God, I thought they were going to get a hack. If RoboCop 2 is slightly diluted and RoboCop 3 is entirely watered down, then the RoboCop remake is the homeopathic remedy. It's an entirely different solution, but there's lots of pictures of RoboCop on the bottle. Ignoring the TV series and animated series in between, 21 years passed by from RoboCop 3 to RoboCop 2014, as I'll call it here. Directed by Jose Padilla, it loosely follows the same story as the original movie. Alex Murphy is a policeman who is almost killed, this time because some of his colleagues are dirty and want to keep him and his nose out of their boss's business. Murphy is rebuilt into RoboCop by a wealthy and amoral corporation who are looking to change the rules within the US that will allow them to field robot cops. And ultimately, Murphy pursues not only the people who put him into metalware, but also a corrupt police force and the bad people at Omnicorp. The critical difference here is Murphy wakes up knowing who he is. He has no memory loss, and although he has access to databases, he is still, in terms of personality, himself. As the film progresses, Omnicorp takes away his personality and makes him into a machine.
Thomas King, you're under arrest.
RoboCop 2014 is entirely different tonally. It has fun moments where Samuel L. Jackson is shouting down the camera, but they're fun, not funny, and they're fun because Samuel L. Jackson has great on-screen presence. Kicking RoboCop in the nuts, that weird bit where ED-209 falls down some stairs, shooting around someone and telling them to stop smoking, this, to me, is what RoboCop is tonally, and it's what made the original and its prequels different. RoboCop wasn't just another shooter. It has satire, and it was funny. It didn't take itself seriously. I mean, how could it? It's called RoboCop. It's about a cyborg policeman who is seemingly bulletproof despite having exposed flesh around his mouth. RoboCop 2014 might not be terrible, but it isn't fun. The performances might be fine, but without that level of playfulness, its gaps in logic come through. The practicalities of the first film didn't matter. You weren't meant to believe RoboCop was reality. Here you might be left wondering why, if Omnicorp has the technology to detect criminals with facial recognition, they don't just put that technology into body cams. Why upload the drool-inducing Detroit police database into Murphy's brain just before he's got to speak to an audience and not test it first? Why did only his face and hand survive? Didn't a bomb go off in his face? Didn't his face take the brunt of an explosion? Didn't a bomb go off in his face? None of that should matter. None of it really does. It just shines through because it takes itself so seriously. Honestly, RoboCop 2014 is like if they remade Tango and Cash with Michael Fassbender and Daniel Day-Lewis. It's schlocky, but it's not good schlocky. It also has one of the worst choices for music over its credits. This is how the film ends, with Samuel L. doing his mouthy pundit bit, and then this.
I'm Pat Novak. Good night.
It's incongruent and meaningless. The song chosen is there because it's about the law. It might as well have ended with this.
I'm Pat Novak. Good night.
That's the sound that I'm police. That's the sound that I'm police. That's the sound that I'm police.
My point is, it just doesn't fit. And I don't think the script, or the handling of the script, fits with the character. If RoboCop was a new concept in 2014, I still don't think that the character, RoboCop, would fit with the earnestness of this film. It's sluggish and boring. Padilla has reportedly said that he hated working on RoboCop, and that 9 out of 10 of his suggestions were rejected by the studio. Originally intended to be made on a $60 million budget, that number ended up being more like $100 million. And with that, it seems Sony decided the movie would have to be a PG-13. There are some interesting ideas in the remake of RoboCop. Operation Freedom Terran, questions about being in control versus the illusions of being in control, post-traumatic stress disorder, and what it means to be a human. But in its earnestness, the film loses a lot of its bite. I feel as though, even with the jokes and the over-the-top action, the original is far darker. The new one feels as if it's dark because an executive wrote that word down on a whiteboard next to the words futuristic and helmet. 2014's RoboCop did, however, make a lot of money, $242 million. So there's that. Another sequel, leading in from the first film and ignoring both the sequels and remake, has been rumoured. Although I'm tempted to say that I hope it doesn't happen, I think what I really mean when I think things like that is I hope it isn't shit. But one of those probably leads into the other. In fairness to RoboCop the remake, and in fairness really to RoboCop 3, I think as a franchise, RoboCop hasn't been as bastardised as others. Like other franchises, really, in my opinion, the only film that really matters is the first one. Thank you very much for joining me and hearing me prattle on about RoboCop. I hope to see you next time, where I'll be talking about how test audiences shape movies. From Sunset Boulevard to modern day studio inertia. See you then.